So what we were looking at was a gate like the NAND gate, right? Truth table given by this, and what we said was that the corresponding circuit would be constructed out of two blocks. There would be a pull-up network and a pull-down network. The inputs A and B would be connected to both the pull-up as well as the pull-down network, right? So at any point in time, either the pull-up network or the pull-down network will conduct. What happens if it, what do I mean by saying it conducts? It essentially means that it provides a conducting path from one end to the other. Okay? The inputs are only used as controls. The ends of the pull-up or pull-down network are the top and bottom. So if the pull-up network is active or conducting, it essentially means that the output is being connected to VDD. If the pull-down network is active, it means that the output is connected to ground. Obviously, if both the pull-up and pull-down networks are active at the same time, it means we have a short circuit, right, connecting VDD to ground. So that situation should never arise. Similarly, if both pull-up and pull-down are off, the output is floating because it is connected to neither VDD nor to ground. You cannot say what the output voltage is going to be. It's essentially going to be in a sort of high impedance state. The output voltage will be determined by other factors, not by the inputs that we have. Okay? So we want a situation where the pull-up and pull-down networks are designed such that at any given point in time, you always have a direct connection either to VDD or to ground. Okay? So as an example, if I do something like this, there is a problem here because these are not complementary. Okay. In other words, in the situation where we have a 1-0, right, A is equal to 1, B is equal to 0, or the other way around, 0-1, right, we will end up with a situation where the output is connected neither to VDD nor to ground, and essentially you have the two parts disconnected. The output basically disconnected from both ends. Okay, so this is an example of a circuit which is not a valid CMOS gate. Okay, nothing prevents you from building such a circuit, but it is not a useful circuit. It does not implement a logic functionality that you would want to see. Okay, is there any condition under which you might actually want to create something of the sort? There may be. We will look at that later. Right, but the basic thing is this does not by itself implement a logic functionality. Okay, so instead what we see is if we wanted to implement the NAND gate, the pull down network needs to be active, that is the output becomes low when both the inputs A and B are high, and that will get implemented by using this connection. Whereas the pull up network, the output needs to go high whenever either one of the two gates, the two inputs, goes low. Okay, so this is the structure of a CMOS NAND gate. Right? Yeah. So what you can see from this is couple of things. One is, why did I implement a NAND gate instead of an AND gate? Would it have been easier, or would it have been equally easy to implement an AND gate? Right? So this is where that first question in the tutorial that talks about inverting versus non-inverting gates comes into the picture, right? In the CMOS kind of structure, when we are implementing circuits of this sort, it is relatively straightforward to implement inverting gates. Okay? The output stage, the basic structure that we have, this very structure with the pull-up and pull-down networks, means that in some sense we are implementing an inverting kind of logic. Right? Why is that? Because we are applying some inputs which are going to be high. Whenever the inputs are high, what can they do? They can only turn on the pull down network or turn off the pull up network. Okay, so a high input can turn on the pull down network or turn off the pull up network. Either way, the only change that it can make is to cause the output to go low. Okay, so by the very nature of the way that we are constructing this using the separate pull-up and pull-down network, it means that we would naturally be implementing inverting kind of gates. Okay. So if I want to get a non-inverting gate AND gate, what would I do? How would you create an AND gate in CMOS? Invert the output of a NAND gate, right? So in fact, that is pretty much how you do end up constructing it, right? You create a NAND gate, put an inverter at the output, which means that AND gate requires more transistors and typically more area and will have greater delay than a NAND gate. Okay? So all of that is in general true. There may be ways by which you can do some optimizations to reduce the area or delay overheads, but typically the complexity in terms of implementing a NAND gate will be lower than for an AND gate using at least CMOS, right? With some other logic families, it may turn out that either AND and NAND are equally complex or that AND might be easier to build. But we are talking about CMOS right now, and in CMOS, NAND is easier to build than AND. Okay? Alright, so the next question that comes up is, I have decided the structure of the gate, that is, how should the transistors be connected. What's the next question that I would ask over here? What should the sizes of those transistors be? Right? As a designer, that's pretty much all that you need to choose. Once you have decided how the transistors have to be connected and what are their sizes, you are pretty much done. The gate is ready. Of course, there are still some additional steps, which is how do you actually lay it out in an optimal fashion and so on. We'll get to those issues a bit later. For the time being, we are more interested in, as soon as I know the sizes of the transistors, I'm done with the design of the gate. Okay? So the question becomes, how should I choose the sizes of the transistors? Does it matter, first of all? What impact will the choice of sizes of the transistors have on the behavior of the gate? Right? So, as a first cut, let me just consider what happens if I choose minimum size transistors everywhere. Is this acceptable? Will it behave like a NAND gate? First question. Will it behave like a NAND gate or not? Somebody say something confidently. Yes, it will behave like a NAND gate. There's nothing wrong with it, right? This will behave like a NAND gate. There is no issue at all, right? The question is, are these the right sizes to choose? So, for example, what if I instead chose some other sizes? What if I chose a size of 3 for this NAND gate and for this in NMOS, 1 for this one, 5 for this one and 7 for this one. Would this behave like a NAND gate? Yes, it will. Right? What's the difference?
Standing operation.
Huh?
Standing operation.
static operation, what will happen in the static operation? Okay, so the point is, under static conditions, that is when A and B are 0 or VDD, the behavior should actually be completely unchanged. It should behave exactly the same as the previous NAND gate. But two issues. One is, let's say I keep A constant at 0 or 1 or whatever, let's keep it constant at 1, and slowly vary B from 0 to VDD, right? I'll have some point at which it transitions, the output transitions from 1 to 0, right? Initially, what is it? A is equal to 1, B is equal to 0, output is equal to 1. As I increase B, the output should change from 1 to 0, okay? That will happen for some voltage, some value of B, okay? What value will it switch at? Right, that's the sort of switching threshold. It's almost the same question as what we had for the inverter. Okay, now that will actually start depending on the relative sizes of these transistors. Okay, so that's one issue. Just like we calculated the midpoint voltage for a CMOS inverter, you can define something like a switching threshold or a midpoint voltage for a NAND gate. The problem is, since it has two inputs, it is not so easy to define a midpoint voltage anymore. You need to keep one of them static at 0 or at 1 and vary the other one and see how the output changes. If you instead keep the other one constant and vary, so you keep B constant and vary A, you will find that the switching happens at a different value. If you keep both of them shorted together and vary them both simultaneously, you will find that the switching happens at yet another value. Okay? So all of those are different options that you can choose in order to sort of say, okay, maybe the switching threshold is one of the things I would like to optimize. Why? Because I would like to get good noise margins. Okay? But there is also another aspect which, as he pointed out, is the dynamic behavior. What happens when I have a transition, a fast transition on one of the inputs? Okay? So when does a transition on the output take place? Right? A 0 to 1 transition at the output could occur under many different combinations of inputs. Right? So what would I need for the input, for the initial value to be 0, right? The input must have been 1, 1. Okay? This goes to 1, 0 or to 0, 1 or to 0, 0. Right? Similarly, for a 1 to 0 transition at the output, I would have multiple different possible transitions at the input. Okay? I know that the final output is 0, so the final input should be 1, 1, but the initial inputs could have been 0, 1, 1, 0 or 0, 0. Okay? For this transition to take place. Right? Now I can define a propagation delay. How long did that transition on the input take from the time that the input reached the 50% point until the output essentially reaches 50% of its final value? So it will look something like this. This is constant 1. B is changing from 1 to 0 and Y will change from 0 to 1. Okay, if I draw this on a timeline, what I will find is A is constant at 1, B will undergo a transition at some point in time, Y will undergo a transition shortly after that, and there will be a propagation delay that I can define over here. Similarly, I could have various other combinations. I will always define the propagation delay as the time from the 50% transition point on the input to the corresponding 50% transition point on the output. Okay, that's the propagation delay. Now, because there are so many different possible transitions, one of the things which seems likely is are the propagation delays for all of, or rather, let me ask another question. Are the propagation delays for all of those different cases going to be the same? There's no reason why it has to be the same, right? And in fact, it will not be. One of the sort of simple things that you can consider is, we have a situation where the output is going from 0 to 1, okay? So this particular scenario, what happened over here, this is A, this is B, okay? This is connected to the output. A is out of the picture because it's cut off, right? B has been turned on at some time t, okay? The entire charging happens through B, okay? There is another possibility, which is that both A and B undergo a transition, undergo a falling transition at exactly the same time. How can that happen? One simple way is I short them together and use this as an inverter, right? Now what will happen? Current will flow through both paths. Okay? There are two parallel paths. In general, I can expect that the current flowing in the second case is going to be larger than the current flowing in the first case. What will happen to the propagation delay? It will reduce. Okay? More current, charge faster, propagation delay reduces. So clearly I can see that the propagation delay is not going to be the same in all cases. Okay? But we can sort of estimate which one is going to be worse, which is going to be the sort of slower of the two transitions. We know that when only one of the PMOS is charging, right, that's going to be slower than when both PMOS are charging. Okay? So what we do in general while choosing the sizes of transistors is to say, let's try and choose the sizes of the transistors so that in the worst case, the propagation delays should be, or rather the current that can be delivered by this gate for charging the next stage will be the same as what would have been delivered by the reference inverter. Okay? So what does that mean? It means that I now need to choose sizes for these four transistors. For the PMOS, what size should I choose then if I wanted to deliver the same current as the reference inverter? Huh? What was the size of the PMOS in the reference inverter? 2, right? That is 8 lambda, twice minimum size. Okay, so in the reference inverter, I had a PMOS of size 2 and an NMOS of size 1. Okay, that's my definition of reference inverter. So don't ask why I had that. That's my definition. Right? So PMOS of size 2, NMOS of size 1, which means NMOS is minimum size, W equal to 4 lambda, L is equal to 2 lambda. PMOS is twice minimum size, W equal to 8 lambda, L is equal to 2 lambda. Okay? Now I want this NAND gate to also deliver the same current as the PMOS of the reference inverter. So what size should the transistors be? 2 each. Okay. What that means is, at any given point in time, let's say that only A is on, effectively it will look like the reference CMOS inverter. There is one PMOS of size 2 delivering current to the output load. Okay, if only B is on, one PMOS of size 2 delivering current to the output load. But if you are lucky and both of them turn on at the same time, then both A as well as B those two PMOS are going to deliver current to the output load, it will charge faster. But that's not our worst case, that's not the case we are concerned about. Okay? So because of that, I can say that I will choose the size of the PMOS transistors to be of to be 2. Okay? What about the NMOS? I want the same behavior. I wanted the discharge current that comes through the NMOS to be the same as the discharge current that would have come through the reference inverter. Huh? So what happens if I put 1 and 1 over here? Will I get the same current? So what's happening here? There are two transistors in series, right? Think about it in terms of the equivalent resistance of those two transistors, right? If each one had a resistance of R to start with, what's the final resistance? 2R, because they are in series, okay? Now that resistance is an approximation, it's not really a resistance, it's a transistor, it's not a current source, it's not a resistance, but either the equivalent resistance or the equivalent current source are models that help us to understand how the current should flow. Okay? The important point over here is, you can look at it in multiple ways. Either you can think of it as equivalent resistance, now the two of them have been put in series, the effective resistance doubles. The other way you can look at it is, two transistors have been put in series, the effective length doubles. So the W by L has become half. Okay? So either way, this is wrong. If I wanted to get the same effective resistance or the same effective current as the original case, what should I now make the widths be? 2. Okay? Why? Because effectively, one way of thinking about it is, this is now a resistance of R by 2, this is a resistance of R by 2. Total resistance is the sum of both of those. Okay? Once again, this is an approximation, right? Because the reality is not exactly that you are getting the length to be 2L, right? It's not as simple as that, because you actually have a contact in between them, and there is like, so it's not one continuous channel of double the length. Okay? You have two transistors, but they are being stacked one on top of the other, so effectively it sort of looks as though the length has doubled, but it is not one transistor of double the length. Okay? At the same time, you can't really plug in the exact equivalent resistance and say this has now become half. In fact, the situation gets even more complicated, because while the thing is discharging, if you look at the potential at this intermediate node between the two NMOS transistors, that voltage is not at a zero potential. And as its potential changes, there are like multiple other effects, including the body biasing effect and so on, which are going to come into the picture, right? Which will complicate your analysis. But as a first cut approximation, it makes sense for us to say just choose 2 and 2 as the sizes of the NMOS transistors, so that the effective resistance becomes equal to what it was in the original case, or the effective current that it can discharge is the same as what would have been in the case of a reference inverter. Okay? So this is sort of what we use as the basis for choosing sizes of transistors in all CMOS gates. Okay, let's try another example, okay, just to make sure we understand what's going on over here. I want to implement the next, you know, simple gate that we can think of, a NOR gate. What's the behavior of a NOR gate? This is the symbol, schematic symbol, truth table. What should it be? When the input is 0, 0, the output should be 1. Then it's 0, 1, 0. So all the other cases it should be 0. Okay. How will I build this in CMOS? This is my output. I need to design a pull-up network and a pull-down network. Okay. Let's start with a pull-down. What should the pull-down network look like? Parallel NMOS. Why? Because if any one of them is equal to 1, if any one of the inputs is equal to 1, the output should be 0. It should get pulled down to 0. So I have parallel NMOS transistors over here. Any one of them is equal to 1, the output gets pulled down to 0. What about the PMOS? Only when both of them are 0, A is equal to B is equal to 0, should the output get pulled up to 1. Okay? Which means series. So this is the structural solution. This is what it should look like, right? What about the sizes of the transistors? What about the NMOS? The two NMOS transistors, what size should they be? Now once again go back. I mean, worst case is any one of the two transistors is on, okay? And it is trying to discharge the output. Under those conditions, it should essentially pull down as much current as what the reference inverter NMOS would have done. It's only one of them, there's no stack over here, there's no series connection, right? So it's going to be the same size as what it was in the reference inverter, right? So size 1 for each of these. Now the PMOS, you have two PMOS in series. The effective resistance is going to be the sum of the individual resistances. You want that total resistance to be the same as what it would have been for the reference inverter. So what should the sizes of the PMOS be? 4 each. Okay? So is this clear? Why? What happens when I make a PMOS of size 4? Effectively, its resistance, its equivalent resistance is R by 2, where R is sort of the reference inverter resistance. Right? This is also R by 2. So they add up and give you R, same as the reference inverter. Okay? Alright. Now, just this exercise, getting this far, NAND followed by NOR, right? What would you say in general about which is preferable? Which is a better kind of gate, NAND or NOR? Huh? So on what basis are we making such a decision? One of the things that we could say is based on what we sort of expect the different, the total size that we expect from this. Okay, that is one possible sort of metric. The other one is in terms of which is doing, you know, how are the pull-up and pull-down networks going to behave? Okay. Now the problem with the NOR gate is the pull-up part of it, right, is PMOS transistors. PMOS is slower than NMOS. Those transistors are essentially going to take longer, but we have made them wider. But because we made the PMOS wider, the net effect as far as the size is concerned is even more than in the case of the NMOS. Okay. So if you add up the widths of the transistors, which is a rough measure of how big the overall gate is going to be. For the NAND, it is 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2, 8. For the NOR, it is 4 plus 4 plus 1 plus 1, 10. Okay? So in that sense, at least, it is sort of easy to see why we would consider a NAND gate, at least to the first order, slightly better than a NOR gate. Okay? Now, this is true in general. It is in general preferable, at least in these kind of technologies where there is such a huge difference between the PMOS and NMOS, to prefer things which have NMOS series stacks. Okay? Why am I concerned about series stacks? Because when I have a series stack, I need to make all the transistors wider. Making NMOS wider is usually preferable to making PMOS wider, because the PMOS is already wide to start with. I do not want to make it bigger if I can avoid that. Okay? Alright. Let's take this further. Next step is, I'm going to implement a more complex functionality. Right? A dot B plus C, the whole bar. Okay? So, first thing, this is clearly not a sort of trivial gate, right? In the sense that, at least from the Boolean functionality, it requires one OR operation, one AND operation, and then the inversion, right? So, normally, if you were implementing it in terms of discrete gates, you would probably think that you needed three gates in order to implement this, right? But the first thing that let's consider, is this an inverting gate or not an inverting gate? It is inverting, right? One way of looking at it is, of course, there is a bar across the whole thing, which sort of tells you that yes, this is inverting, but it's not as trivial as that, because if I had A dot B bar plus C, the whole bar, for example, that is not an inverting gate, because the B bar is there inside. How did I get that B bar? So in other words, as far as the B to output is concerned, it's not behaving in an inverting fashion. Okay? Whereas over here, the A, B, C, all of them, the basic variables are in their positive form without inversion. And the equation takes all of them, combines them using some AND OR operations, and finally inverts the output. So it is an overall inverting gate. Okay? So it turns out that this can also be realized using a single stage of CMOS logic. CMOS transistors. Okay, so let's see how we would construct that. What should the pull-up and pull-down networks look like for this? Are you talking about pull-up or pull-down? Okay, so typically it's sort of easier to think in terms of the pull-down network first, because it straight away it's a pretty much a direct translation of what you are seeing on the equation. Okay. So let's look at the pull down network. What is it you said? Okay. So what it should look like is A over here in series with the parallel combination of B and C. Why? Because of the functionality that we want. We want the output to be low when A is high and either B or C is high, or both. Okay? So that AND essentially translates into a series combination, the OR translates into a parallel combination, and this is what it looks like. Okay? Is it possible to put the B and C closer to the output and the A below? In other words, would this have been okay? Yeah, this is perfectly fine. Right? There's nothing wrong with this. This will also work. There are other reasons which come in later, which might decide whether the blue circuit or the black circuit is a better one, right? But to a first level of approximation, both of these circuits are exactly the same, right? What about the pull-up network? Now, the pull-up network can also be derived pretty much from what we have over here, right? But a sort of simpler way of thinking about it is to say that, look, we know that the pull-up and pull-down should never be active together. Right? At any given point in time, only one of them should be active. What that means in terms of just looking at the combination of these circuits is that one is the dual of the other. What do I mean by dual? Anything which is in series in the pull down will come in parallel in the pull up, and anything which is parallel in the pull down will become series in the pull up. Okay. Probably a simpler way of writing it is, we look at the equation for y bar, okay, and essentially see how that is to be achieved in terms of when the A's and B's should go to 0, because you want the output to become pulled up to 1. Okay. So what we are saying in other words is, the A followed by BC combination was in series, so in the pull up, A will be in parallel with a series combination of B and C. Okay. This is the structure. Next question, sizes. What should the sizes of all the transistors be? Let's start by looking at the pull down NMOS. What can you say about the sizes of the transistors A, B, C? So the first thing that we can say is, we have A followed by something. Okay. So one way of looking at it is, I want to divide that resistance which comes in the pull down path equally between both of those. Okay, which means basically that R by 2 for A, R by 2 for the second part. Okay, which means to get a resistance of R by 2 for A, I need it to be of size 2. The second part, B and C, are in parallel. The worst case is when only one of them is active. The best case is when both are active. Right, so two parallel resistances is good. That sort of reduces the resistance. But we are concerned about the worst case. In the worst case, only one of them is active, still the resistance should be R by 2, the sizes are 2N. Okay. Now, the pull-up network. Similar kind of analysis. In the worst case, only one of the two parts is doing the pull-up. It should have an effective resistance which is the same as the reference inverter. So let's consider A as the pull-up path. So what should its size be? 2, right? Same as for the reference inverter. If A is not active, then the BC path may be active, right? The combination of B and C in series should give an effective resistance of 2, therefore, or of R. Therefore, each of them should be R by 2, which means the sizes should be 4. Now, it is possible to come up with some slightly different solutions for this. I can come up with an effective equivalent resistance of R for the pull down without, you know, in a different way. Let's say that I divide the resistance as R by 3 and 2R by 3. Okay? So there are different ways by which I could achieve a similar kind of result. Now, at the end of the day, this is simple. Just from a symmetric point of view, it makes sense. And it gives us good first level estimates for what should the sizes be. Okay. In practice, what you will find is that the exact sizes that are chosen when people design such gates is not exactly in these proportions. What they do is they use these in order to estimate what the sizes should be, and then sort of keep tweaking those so that you get good values for rise and fall time, for the midpoint voltages, area, and so on. Okay, so a number of sort of secondary effects come into the picture when you are choosing the final sizes. Okay. Now, yeah. So this kind of a gate, by the way, is something which is called a, and if you look at the logic functionality, right, it is OR of B and C followed by AND with A followed by inverter. Okay, sometimes this is also drawn as a separate kind of gate where we draw it like this. Right? As one symbol, and we call this a OAI gate or AND invert. Okay? And OAI gates are sort of considered standard gates that are sometimes found in the library of gates that are available for you to do designs. Okay? So now what happens? How does actual large scale digital design work? Right? When you are asked to design a large circuit, you don't go around designing each individual NAND gate, NOR gate, inverter and deciding what the sizes of the transistors should be. Okay? Typically what happens is, somebody already does the work of designing these gates and gives you a library of cells. Okay? It's sometimes called a standard cell library. Right? So a standard cell library, for example, would include things like an inverter, NAND gate, NOR gate, maybe an OAI gate, maybe AOI gates. Right? A whole bunch of things like this. In addition, it might even have things like XOR gates. Right? Which, so far if you look at it, we don't have a simple way of implementing an XOR gate in CMOS. Right? It can be done, but not in a single stage CMOS. Right? Because it's not an inverting gate. Okay? There will be other things, for example, that include things like half adders and full adders, which take multiple inputs, multiple outputs, and so on. Okay? So what happens in these cases is people go ahead and design a set of gates. They say this is where the input should be, this is where the outputs will be. We will actually do the final layout. Okay? What do I mean by layout? I will actually create the silicon mask which says this is exactly the pattern that needs to be created on the silicon in order to get a certain functionality. Okay? And usually what people will do then is they'll say they will convert all of these into blocks, rectangular blocks of different sizes. Okay? And the logic designer then just needs to take all of those rectangular blocks and put them together so that they all fit within the space that is allocated to them. Now that's the tricky part. That's something we have not been looking at all so far. We have just talked in terms of functionality of the gates. We can draw schematics of gates. We can say this is how they should be connected to get a certain functionality. That how should they actually look on silicon? How much area should they take? How should they be positioned relative to each other? That's also something you need to address when you are doing the final design. Okay? So what happens in practice is we'll have a large silicon die. And what we'll do is we'll create rows. Sometimes they are called channels, right? Where you can place these different cells. Okay? So the channels essentially say that this is the place where you are allowed to have cells. Why is the channel concept useful? Because one of the things that you can do by having the idea of a channel is, you can just say the entire top part of the channel, I will supply VDD, and the bottom part of the channel, I will supply ground. Similarly, for the next channel, I will put VDD over here. And I'll put ground over here, right? And have those alternating. Once I do this, I can start looking at optimizations. I might be able to sort of flip it around and say I will combine two of the grounds together. Right? All kind of other optimizations can be done. But the core idea is your channels are essentially defining places where VDD and ground are readily available. and all of your cells can just be sort of placed there and are guaranteed to get the correct VDD and ground connections. Then it becomes a question of how do I take the inputs and outputs and connect them up properly. That I still need to do using some metal layer connections, right? But the VDD and ground are automatic just by placement of the cells. Okay, what that automatically means is the height of every cell now has to be fixed. Okay, so standard cell based design, what it typically says is, I will first try and identify a set of cells that I want for my library. Okay, NAND gate, NOR gate, maybe AND gate, OR gate, inverter for sure, inverter of different sizes, NAND gate of different sizes, all of those will form part of your library. Okay, somebody will sit and spend a lot of time optimizing and tuning that. The initial sizes of the NAND gate, NOR gate transistors will be guided by whatever we looked at so far. But some additional tuning will be required in order to see what actually gives you good propagation delays, good area, all of those. Right? And once they have decided this is a good gate, they'll put it as part of a library, and you as a designer can just pick that library and say, I will choose all of these and place them in the correct way, connect the inputs and outputs and get the functionality that I want. Okay, so we will have this as an assignment going further into the course, where we essentially pick a set of gates from a standard cell library, and each of you will essentially design that gate, meaning that you actually have to choose the layout, you have to choose the size of the transistors, do the layout, get back the extracted circuit, figure out what the functionality and, you know, how the propagation delay and so on are going to be, and finally characterize it. In other words, give me a data sheet for that gate, which tells me everything that I need to know about the gate, and I can use it. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now.